100 genes that are upregulated. But then out of those genes, there are 80 that have a particular goal term, although in the whole genome, 20,000 genes, there are only 100 genes with that goal term. We can use these kind of a binomial proportional test to see, okay, in out of the 20,000 genes, there are only 100 genes with that goal term, so the chance of every random gene with that goal term is only 0.005. And if we totally have 200 genes that are differentially expressed, or upregulated, and 80 of them has this goal term, what is that probability? You know, what's that chance? And so X is the 80, 200 times 0.005 is your expected, divided by this Bernoulli cloud calculation. And so you'll get this z-score, you can check the z-table, it's like a ridiculously small p-value, right? So you know it's significant. Another way to do this is by the chi-square test. We mentioned this. This is like a 2x2 table, you know. Up genes with this goal term, not up genes with this goal term. Up genes without this goal term, and not up genes, and not with this goal term. And this is what we observed. And each of the numbers in the parentheses is what we expected. For example, the expected for this one is this number times this number divided by this number. Okay, so you can do this calculation for every one of them. And so then you check the chi-square table, all of the four terms. The observed minus the expected squared divided by your expected, and you sum over the full term. You can also check the chi-square table, and it will give you a ridiculous p-value as well. And so, let me ask you. Yeah, so there are tools available to do this. Actually, for a while, there are like 200 tools available. The ones that we can use quite a bit, there's Amigo, Gorilla, or Great, also David. There are also like gene ontology tools on BioConductor. You can do this on command line. Some of these are online tools. They vary by the specific, like a statistical test, but roughly it's the same idea. And then it's just like whether the user interface is friendly or not. So let me ask, for this particular test, we are testing on one goal term. How many goal terms do we need to test in total? Do we test on other goal terms, or do we just test one? Like for a tool like David, right? You input your genes that are upregulated and or downregulated, compared to all the genes on your microarray, and it will say, okay, your upregulated genes are enriched in goal term like metabolism, some cell cycle, or something. It will just give you a bunch of terms with their different level of enrichment, right? And say, oh, then you can write a paper to say, I did this microarray experiment, I treated the cell with a drug, and then I see, instead of these 300 genes being upregulated, you say, we see genes upregulated to be enriched in specific pathways or specific biological functions, or related to some like cytoplasm or some mitochondria or something, right? You can describe it with a text. The question is, how many goal terms does these two have to test when you give it a gene set of 300? Melissa? They have to test every single one of them. Okay? So imagine you have a gene. Remember, gene ontology is like a tree, and there are many nodes, some are more detailed than others. And so, for example, if a particular gene has a gene ontology term like really towards the edge, they also belong to the parent, the grandparents, all the way to the great-grandparents. So if you have a gene ontology term for this one, when you test this, it's also true, right, for that gene. And then when you test this goal term, this is also true, and so on. And so these goal term analysis not only need to know the specific gene ontology assigned to that gene, it needs to know all the way in the tree, because the parents, grandparents, great-grandparents all apply. And you have to test, like, if you remember, it's like 180,000 goal terms to find the ones that are enriched, there are multiple hypothesis testing problems. You are testing 183,000 terms, right? And at the end, you report, it's like a differential gene expression. You're testing 20,000 genes, at the end, you say these 200 genes are differentially expressed. For gene oncology, it's the same. You test 183,000 gene oncology terms, and at the end, you report to the user, these ones are enriched in your 300 upregulated genes. So there is definitely a multiple hypothesis testing problem. And so when you use a David, how do you correct for multiple hypothesis testing? So every enriched gene ontology term, in addition to a standard p-value from this calculation, it will also give you a FDR adjusted p-value. So FDR is similar to a p-value, except it's usually a little higher than a p-value, just say after adjusting for multiple hypothesis, whether it's still significant. I think for tools like David, it's using the Benjamini-Hochberg method and give you that adjusted p-value, which is the FDR. Okay? But then there are cases when, if you look at the differentially expressed genes, it seems like the experiment is done well, that you get something like this. There are actually not, well, maybe one, two, three genes that are differentially expressed, or maybe four or five. Very few differential genes. Usually, if you do a microarray experiment, afterwards you do Lima or whatever, you get, say, less than 50 genes. It's highly unlikely you will do gene oncology analysis and get something meaningful. So we mentioned differential expression, you want to have a few hundred genes to a few thousand genes. If you have 10,000 genes, that's not going to give you anything meaningful. But if you only have 10 genes that are differentially expressed, that won't give you something meaningful. And so people started looking into cases when you do an experiment and you look at differential genes, there are very few genes that are differentially expressed. And sometimes the two studies, both similar design, similarly conducted, and you look at the differential gene, both have low level of differential genes. And you look at those, these 10 genes that are differential between the two studies, they are not at all in agreement, right? Those 10 genes versus the other studies, 5 genes, zero overlap. And so you're like wondering, is the experiment really giving us anything? Is it just total garbage or not? It turns out the gene ontology in these cases can help. So in this situation, in this particular study, they are looking at some gene expression versus another treatment, like some treatment, this control condition versus a treatment condition. If you look at just the differential expression, there's nothing. But if you say, let's look at those genes that are annotated by a specific gene ontology terms, say, chromosome organization or something, you look at a particular GO term and then label those genes as red in here. Do you notice something?
They're all below the line.
They are all below the line. Perfect. Yeah, well, not all, but like a significant amount of them are below this line, which means that in the treatment condition, compared to the control, they're a little bit lower expressed. Even though none of them make the cutoff, it's still actually a kind of interesting observation. And so in this particular study, the original study, they did something like this. They look at the two studies that were conducted at two different labs with similar design, and neither of them have many differentially expressed genes. But if you look at each gene ontology terms and ask, there would be some genes you label them red dots, and you can see that they're kind of random and equally up or down compared to this line. But then, interestingly, in these two studies, even though the significantly differential genes like these have no overlap, they do have some gene ontology terms where all of the genes annotated as that gene ontology show an overall trend of downregulation or upregulation. And so this one is still interesting. And so they develop a computational method called the gene set enrichment analysis, which is like, if somebody predefined a gene set, gene ontology, before this experiment, the gene ontology was already defined. actually enrichment in here. And so at that time, the group used a non-parametric test to look at this. The way they tested it is using a Kolmogorov-Smirnov test. The idea is like this. If we look at all of the genes in this microarray experiment and rank them based on their fold change, point one is like tenfold change in the opposite direction, and this is tenfold change. Okay, so initially we were, so this is asking how many genes, what percentage of genes have a fold change below this value. Okay, so there are not so many genes with tenfold change either in the treatment or the control condition. So initially, it's pretty close to zero. So this would mean, well, it doesn't matter which direction, you can say this would mean the treatment is really low and the control is really high, right? And the control is 10 times more than the treatment. There are not so many genes. But then as you increase the fold change cutoff, you know, how many genes are something, well, actually, sorry, this one, the black line is the real control sample. So, sorry, all the genes in your microarray experiment. Because roughly you would expect about, actually this study is not done so well, roughly you would expect about 50% of the genes at around one fold change, right? Which means they are not, you know, most genes are not differentially expressed. But then if you have your own gene sets, you know, the ones that are the red dots here, you ask how many of those genes are below a certain threshold. So by the way, eventually you will get 100% because say no gene, well, 100% of the genes have a fold change below 100-fold, right? Initially, like no gene has the opposite 100-fold. And so this is kind of the genome-wide average, and this dotted line will be what is the cumulative percentage for the genes that are annotated with a particular GO term. And then you look for the distance at every fold change. You look for where you have the maximum distance between your genome-wide background versus your gene, or what your gene of interest for that GO term. And that maximum distance can measure, you know, how big is the, you know, whether it's a significant difference. So the Kolmogorov-Smirnov test can give you this, because you don't really care what the actual value is. You just look at what percentage of the sample or the genes really are below certain fold change. Okay? And so this way you can test for situations like this and say, ah, genes annotated to have a particular gene ontology term are super enriched, in this case lower expressed than in the treatment compared to the control. And it's still biologically meaningful. And then from this, they were able to find similarities between two studies that otherwise have no significant differential genes. So with this, do you have to worry about multiple hypothesis testing? Mir.
So it was non-parametric, right?
Yes. Non-parametric in that is, oops, sorry. In the original analysis, so you only care about the ranking of the genes, you know, which one has ranking above 1 or 0.1 or 10, and then you compare with the ranking of the differential genes in here. Is there multiple hypothesis testing?
I mean, you're just doing one test, right?
Why one test?
Because you're comparing the distributions of the two sets.
So, for example, in this situation, the input is not one gene. The input is like a gene ranked by the fold chain, right? You have genome-wide expression level. At the end, it will tell you this particular gene set, or like gene ontology term, are enriched in those genes that are a little bit downregulated. Another gene term, or gene ontology term, is enriched for the genes that are, maybe you try another gene ontology term, they are a little bit above the line. So you do have to test every gene ontology term as well, because every GO term defines the list of genes annotated as that GO term. Does that make sense? And so you run a tool, it will actually give you, okay, there are 183,000 GO terms. Each go term is a list of genes, and we want to see whether that list of genes are significantly up or down regulated overall, and it will give you, out of the 183,000, these 10 are overall either high or low. Okay, so there is definitely molecular hypothesis testing issue. So this was the original tool. Later on, you know, like people also feel like, well, if you believe the expression microarray data is kind of normally distributed, you could also run this in a parametric test like this. So supposedly this is kind of the fold change. You look at all of these genes, the fold change between the treatment and the control. And the mu is, in this case, zero. Expected is no differential expression of these genes. And then this is the observed fold change for these genes. This is the expected, in this case, zero, divided by the, you know, the number of samples, or number of, sorry, not samples, number of genes with red dots annotation, with that gene ontology annotation, and also normalized by the standard deviation. Because the more genes you have, if you only have three genes with that gene ontology term, you are more, it should have more noise. But if you have like 300 genes annotated with that goal term, you would really expect this thing to be close to zero, right? So you normalize by the total gene count with that annotation. And you could also run this by a parametric test. So recently, the Broad has developed this tool. GeneSight enrichment analysis is like this. So some of these are actually real gene ontology annotations, but also this group, they actually done a really good work. They were like, if we look at whatever other microarray studies that other people have done, and maybe that study has 300 upregulated genes and 200 downregulated genes, we could put those 200 and 300 genes as also a gene set. It's unrelated to the study that you're interested in. So supposedly, I just did some, I found a drug, I'm treating a cell with this drug, and I see some genes that are up or down regulated, and I have no clue what this thing does. What is this drug doing, right? And so you input this into the GeneSight enrichment analysis, it will just test, in addition to testing all the gene sets that's annotated by gene ontology, it can also test for what other microarray experiment that people have done before, looking at the list of upregulated genes or downregulated genes, right? And then they might say, oh, when you treat the cell with the drug, those genes that are upregulated is similar to some other people's experiment when they knock down a particular gene. And so you might say, ah, maybe my drug is targeting that gene. That's why the genes are also enriched. Does that make sense? So whatever gene set in this database they define, it could be defined by other people's microarray experiment. It could be defined by your gene ontology terms and other whatever annotation people come up with. And then it will show you something like this. Okay. So this just means sometimes you see there's a line. The green line can be either above this middle one or below the middle one. It actually means a different thing. So you look at here, this is from the most upregulated genes to the most downregulated genes, similar to a heat map, okay? And so we're asking, and then the ones that are having a line here is the genes that are annotated to have a specific gene term, a gene ontology term, or to be previously defined as differentially expressed in some other people's study. Okay, so these are defining the gene sets. And so you are asking, out of all of my genes that are differentially, so all of the genes in my study, from the most upregulated to the most downregulated, are the genes defined by a specific gene set a little bit skewed to the left or a little bit skewed to the right? Okay, because if a gene ontology term or if a gene set has nothing to do with my experiment, the genes should be randomly scattered on this, right? Some genes are up, you know, like this bars would be randomly scattered. But if the gene that if this particular gene set are related to my study, if these genes either are skewed to the left, in this case, a lot of the genes annotated in that gene set are upregulated in my study, then the line will be above. And in this case, you can see that most of the genes annotated with this particular gene set are skewed to the right. That's most of these genes are downregulated with that pathway. Okay, so you can actually use this, they call it the leading edge. It's kind of like looking at the gene. You know, genome-wide, this is the distribution of up or down-regulated genes of my gene set. And you look at those annotated as having some gene ontology term or, you know, whatever gene set, and you ask whether those sets are skewed to the left or skewed to the right. Okay? Yeah, sorry, I don't know your name.
Ellen.
Ellen, okay.
So what does it mean when, like, okay, so there are a lot of, okay, I'm looking at the right bottom.
Yes, this one.
Yeah. So yeah. What does it mean when all the way at the, like the end, when a lot of those genes, like, should be downregulated, but then the enrichment score is really high?
Oh, but so, because remember, eventually, if you say the fold change has to be below certain level, eventually, or above certain level, all the genes will be below that fold change. Right? At the end, they all go back to zero. Because when the fold change is extreme enough, all the genes will have a fold change below 200.
The zero bar is up at the top.
Yeah, so this is kind of your zero bar. And this is saying a lot of the genes that are annotated with this gene ontology are upregulated. And then eventually, fold change, this is kind of a fold change cutoff, right? And so this is saying, yeah, so more and more genes, initially it's not a problem, then gradually more and more genes are downregulated with this gene set. And then that can kind of show you whether a specific experiment or a specific gene ontology from the previous database annotated gene sets are related to your study of interest. Okay? And so, gene set enrichment, there's a tool, it's actually in homework 2 now, but only for graduate students. For the undergraduate student, you can run this David for just kind of get the differentially expressed genes, you run it, you get some gene ontology terms, but you can try this as well. The gene set enrichment, there is also a web tool. You input your gene list, it's genome-wide. Every gene, you know, there is a fold change. And then, so it's every gene with a number, every gene with a number, and it will just show you whether some pre-existing gene set, whether defined by gene ontology or whether it's defined by other people's microarray, are related to your gene of interest. And it will also give you some information. You say, you know, say previously, some people compared primary cancer versus metastatic tumor, and they see these genes really high. And I'm seeing this in my drug treatment or whatever, that can give you some idea as well, okay? Yeah, so this is kind of using prior knowledge, whether it's gene ontology or other people's microarray experiment, to help you understand your study. And so you don't need to have differential expression, like a significant differential gene. As long as you can rank your genes, you can do this analysis. It's just looking at the skews to the left or to the right. Okay. Melissa.
So will those other experiments also be included in the adjustment FDR?
Yes. In this case, so see, gene ontology has 183,000 tests, right? But say this gene set enrichment, they probably scraped a geo, you know, microarray database. They got, however, say 10,000 other experiments. Then the total number of tests will also increase, so you need to adjust for that as well. Okay, so they also do the multiple hypothesis testing, which is, you can see here, the P is this and the Q is 0.1. That Q is the FDR adjusted P value. Okay, so it's not super significant, probably because this gene set is still not too big. If you have a big gene set and this is really black, you know, all the dots or the bars are on the right, that's a significant range. Right? Questions? Lucy?
Is it possible that the most significantly expressed genes are like at the very end, that it doesn't return back to zero?
Eventually everything will return to zero because nothing is all below 2,000 or something. Okay? Ah, batch effect. So we are assuming that the other microarray experiment has been batch effect removed in this gene set. If they are not so batch effect removed, hopefully they don't have enough differential genes to really define a gene set. You know, like it could be that in this, I don't know how many things are in this database. It could be some of these studies, they didn't return anything because of batch effect, or they never get hit on. Right? I mean, what is the chance that, that say, your differential gene is really because of the ozone level of the incubator? And then in that study, it's also the ozone level of the incubator. And then you saw there's a significant overlap, but then that study was maybe annotated as a totally different biological study. Yeah, I think the chance is pretty small, okay? Yeah, so those will never get hit up. All right, let's start the recording.